In this video, we're going to solve question 13 from the specimen paper for the 2023 computer science syllabus. This is the long programming question, which was added to replace the pre-release material from last year's syllabus. This question supplies us with two arrays and two variables: student name, student mark, class size, and subject number. In the question, they say that the arrays and the variables have already been set up and the data has been stored. And at the end, they tell us that we do not need to initialize the data in the array. So I've created some sample data so that we can run and test the program. Let's go through the structure of these two arrays to understand the data that it holds. First, we have student name. In the question, they say that student name is a 1D array containing the names of students in a class. This is what the student name array could look like, where each element is a string containing a first name. Student mark is a 2D array, which contains the marks for each subject for each student. The position of each student's data in the two arrays is the same. So the student mark array could look something like this, where each of these inner arrays contains a list of marks for each student. These two arrays are linked by indexes, meaning that each element at each index is related. So for the first student, Emma, her marks will be stored in the first element of this 2D array. So from this array, we can tell that there are three subjects, since every student is taking three subjects. Then for the second student, Noah, his marks are stored in the second position of this array, and so on and so on. So the length of this array is going to be the same as the length of this array. Then within this array, we have one-dimensional arrays. The length of these is going to be defined by the number of subjects. These two variables are given to us by the program: class size, which contains the number of students in the class, which is again the length of student name and the length of student mark. Then we have the variable subject number, which contains the number of subjects that have been studied. So this variable defines the length of these inner arrays. We're going to solve each of these requirements one by one. Starting with the first requirement, the question says to calculate the combined total mark for each student for all of their subjects. So for every student, we want to work out the total mark for all of these subjects, meaning we're going to add these three numbers and we'll get a single number. The outcome from this first requirement will look something like this. We'll have a one-dimensional array, which contains the total marks for each of these inner arrays. This array would be linked to the student name based on the index. So the total mark for Emma would be 200, for Noah it would be 185, and so on. To do this, we're going to write a totaling algorithm, which is going to be executed as many times as there are students. Usually with a totaling algorithm, we would define a single variable called total and set it to zero. But this would only work out the total for a single student. In this case, we want to work out the total for all of the students that are present in the student mark array. So the outcome needs to be an array which contains integers. Let's define this as a blank array. And whenever we create a new variable, we always want to label it with a comment noting what the data type is. In this case, it is an array of integers. As we said before, with a totaling algorithm, we usually want to set the total to start at zero. In this case, we are doing five totals at the same time, meaning we need to initialize this array with five zeros. But of course, this is sample data, so we're not going to simply write five zeros, as that would be non-modular. Instead, we'll write a for loop that loops up to the number of class size. Let's go ahead and do that. We can use the range function, starting at zero and going up to class size. Then inside the for loop, we'll append a zero to the end of total. We now want to work out the total for each student. So we're going to be looping through our student mark array. Then inside that for loop, we'll loop through the individual marks that the student achieved for that subject. Let's start with the first for loop. The counter for this for loop will be called student counter, and we can use the range function to start from zero and go up to class size, since that is the same size as student mark. Then for each student, we want to work out the total mark of their subjects. So we'll do another for loop, and we'll use subject counter as our counter variable. Again, we'll use the inRange function, starting at zero, going up to subject number, as this will be looping through the inner arrays. We can now select a single mark from this array, using the student mark array. And since this is a 2D array, we need two indexes. The first index is going to be the student counter, as that is the current student we're looking at. The second index will be the subject counter. This will give us an integer, which is going to contain a mark. We want to now add this to the position in the total array, which is going to be indexed by student counter. We'll use the plus equal operator to add it to that total. The total array should now look like this. After these for loops, let's print out the total array to see if it prints out the right totals. When we run the program, we get the correct totals printed out as an array. So that is the first requirement complete. The next requirement is to calculate the average mark for each student for all of their subjects rounded to the nearest whole number. To calculate the average mark, we'll take the totals and we'll divide them by the number of subjects that each student is taking. The outcome of this requirement should also be a one-dimensional array that contains the averages for each student's position. So, up here, let's define a new array called average, and we'll set that to a blank array. Again, we want to mention that this is going to be an array of integers. The question says it needs to be rounded to the nearest whole number, so we can be sure that we want to store integers. Then we'll initialize this array just like we did with the total array. We can just copy and paste this for loop, but this time we want to append to the average array. This inner for loop determines the average for a single student. So after this for loop, we'll have a total at this position in the total array. We can use this to determine the average at student counter. So we'll say average at the position of student counter is going to be set to the average. So take the total and divide it by the subject number. We can say total at the position of student counter, then divide it by the subject number. If we do this kind of division, we're going to get a float number, which we don't want, since the question asks us to round it to the nearest whole number. To round numbers, we can simply use the int function. However, the int function is just going to cut off the decimal portion of our division. What that means is if a student gets 79.9%, then this will be rounded down to 79, since the int function cuts off this 0.9 decimal. The question asks us to round to the nearest whole number. So we need to round this up actually to 80%. To do this, there's a trick that we can use where we take the division before converting it to an integer and we add a 0.5 to it. If the student gets, let's say, 79.5%, this will add 0.5% and make it 80, which rounds up correctly. If the student gets 79.4%, then the nearest whole number is 79. So adding 0.5 will get it to 79.9%, and then the int function is going to convert that down to 79. So there we have the averages for each of the students. Let's print those out just to make sure that they're correct. Let's run this and we'll see that we get the averages, and that looks correct. The next requirement is to output for each student their name, combined total mark, average mark, and grade awarded. So let's remove these print statements. And for each of the students, we want to print out this information. Whenever we use a print statement, we always want to give it context. So we never just want to print out a single variable, even though we did it just now. If someone else is using our program, we always want to tell them what the output is displaying. Just numbers on the screen don't mean much unless we're the programmer. So the first thing we want to output is the name. Let's write name, colon, as a string. And then we'll select the name from the student name array. We'll use student counter again as our index, and that should select the first name from the student name array. Then we want to print out their combined total mark. That's stored in the total array. So we can print out combined total mark with a colon, and then we can select total at the position of student counter. Next, we want to print out their average mark, which is stored in average at student counter. So let's print out the average mark and we'll put average at student counter. Let's add one more print state afterwards to add a new line between each student output. The next output is the grade awarded. We haven't yet calculated the grade awarded value, so let's go ahead and do that. The question gives us some more information about awarding a grade. they tell us that students are awarded a grade based on their average mark. We've got the average mark stored in average at student counter, so we don't have to worry about that. We then have a table, which gives us average mark and the grade which should be awarded. So grades that are greater than or equal to 70 should get distinctions. Equal to 55 and less than 70 should be a merit. 40 and less than 55 should be a pass, and anything less should be a fail. So this means we need to test the average mark that we've calculated against these grade thresholds and print out if they got a distinction, a merit, a pass, or a fail. This should be easy to do with a few different if-elif statements. So let's start with our first if statement, remembering that we want to stay inside this for loop, and we'll say if the average mark at the student counter is greater than or equal to 70. This first grade threshold means that a distinction is awarded. So let's go ahead and inside this print statement, output grade distinction. This grade threshold of 70 is a value that doesn't change whilst the program is running. It might, however, be a value that we want to change later if we determine a distinction should be higher. For example, it should be 80%. Since this is an important bit of data, we never want to write it as a literal. Instead, we want to write it as a constant at the top of the program. So before defining all of our variables, we'll create a constant called distinction. Constants should always be defined in Python in capital letters, and we'll assign this to 70. Then we can use this constant in the if statement in place of the 70. Now, if we ever wanted to change the grade thresholds, we would just have to look at the first line and say that a distinction should maybe now be 80%. We can do the same thing for the rest of these grade thresholds. To get a merit, you have to get greater than or equal to 55%. So let's write in merit and 55. To be graded a pass, you need to achieve greater than or equal to 40. So let's write the constant pass, and we'll assign this to 40. Then we can finish off our if-elif statements. The first one checks if we got a distinction. So if the mark was greater than or equal to 70, then we can write an elif and say if the average at student counter is greater than or equal to the merit constant. So if it is greater than or equal to 55, that means that they got a merit. So we'll print grade merit. Then we'll test if they got a pass. So again, we'll say if the average is greater than or equal to the constant pass, we'll then print grade pass. And finally, if they got less than 40, we can do an else statement and we'll print out that they failed. So grade fail. After this if elif else chain, we'll print out a new line just so it separates the output for each student. Let's test the program and see if it outputs the correct data. When we run the program, we see that we've got the name, the combined total mark and the average mark, and also the grade awarded for each individual student. So that is this requirement complete. The last requirement says to calculate, store, and output the number of distinctions, merits, passes, and fails for the whole class. So this looks to be a counting algorithm, meaning that we want to count the number of distinctions, merits, passes, and fails for every student. A counting algorithm always starts with variables, which are assigned to zero. So let's create these four variables in our variable definition stage. Let's create a variable for the number of distinctions, the number of merits, the number of passes, and the number of fails. Remember, with the counting algorithm, we always assign these to zero. And for every variable we make, we always want to say what the data type is. In this case, these are all integers, so we'll just add a comment after each of the definitions. Also notice that we forgot to do so for these three constants, so let's add integers for each of these constants. The second part of a counting algorithm is a for loop, which we already have, as we're looping through all the students. The third part of the counting algorithm is to increment the variable that we're counting. And we can use our if-elif-else chain to do exactly that. If the student got a distinction, then we'll increment the distinction number. And we'll do that using the plus equal operator. We can then do the same for merit. So if the student got a merit, we'll increase the number of merits. The same thing for pass, again using our plus equal operator, and the same thing for fail. So we've calculated and we've stored the number of distinctions, merits, passes, and fails. We now want to output this. So after this main for loop, we're going to output these four bits of data. Again, with your print statements, you always want to give context as to what is being output. So first, we'll say the number of distinctions. Then we'll print out the distinction number. We'll do the same for merits, the same thing for passes, and the same thing for fails. Let's test the program to see if it prints this data out at the end. And at the end, we get the data that is output to the terminal. So that completes the last requirements. There is one more part to this question, which is to add comments to explain how your code works. When you're adding comments, you don't have to comment every single line. For example, we don't need to comment on every single print statement, as what is being output is fairly obvious. Instead, we want to comment on blocks of code, explaining what that block of code is doing. So, starting with these first two for loops, we can write a comment above it, saying initialize total and average arrays with zeros. It is a simple explanation and doesn't take up too much space, but is sufficient in telling us what this block does. In the next for loop, we can write a comment, which explains that we're iterating through every student in the class. Then for each student, we can comment that we are working out the total and the average for the student's marks. We don't need to comment on the print statements, since it should be fairly obvious as to what is being output by the context strings. Then for our if-elif-else chain, we can say how we're checking the average against each of these grade thresholds and incrementing the corresponding grade category variable. Again, we don't need to go into too much detail for each of these individual statements, since they're all performing similar actions. With the last print statements, we don't need to comment on these, as again, it's fairly obvious as to what they're printing out based on these context strings. So there is this question complete. I'll link the code in the description of this video, so if you want to run it for yourself and test it, then you can go ahead and do so on Replits.